Good morning and welcome to worship this morning. And as Kirk knocks down the music for us, but welcome to this glorious day that the Lord has made for us all. My name is Pastor Roger Behrens, and I'm the pastor here at Bethany Lutheran Church. And I hope this day, as chilly as it may be, is filled with grace and glory for you. Now, our sanctuary last week was up over 30 people. This week, we're back down to a low number as we have shut down our in-person worship, or not really shut down, but reverted back to our phase one approach, primarily because of the increase in numbers of COVID positive cases in our county, Chemung County. It saddens me that we have to do that, but I knew going into this that this potential existed in a great way, and now we're having to live out that reality. So I think it kind of is fitting with our lessons today as the Israelites were whining and complaining in the wilderness. I think today might seem a little bit like wilderness territory for us as well. But the thing is God always stepped in and provided blessings upon blessings for those whining Israelites. So also we have kind of shut down our Sunday school until we can move through this. Hopefully this will be a quick passing and we'll be right back in moving forward as a faith community, so blessed as we are. So what I wanted you to focus on today, when we tend to be filled with anxieties and fears, where do we place our trust? Who do we call on, or may we continue to lean on our faith in God through Jesus Christ, or do we tend to point fingers and blame others? Something to think about as we walk through this journey together today. Now, if you would, please, I'd like for you to turn over to your front cover of your bulletin and let us say our vision statement together. We are a faith community in partnership with our neighbors, discerning needs with dignity and respect in service together to benefit all of God's kingdom through Christ. And now I invite you all to sit back and prepare yourselves, center yourselves on worship as we listen to Francis play this wonderful prelude for us today.
Thank you. Let's praise God together.
For God is great and worthy of our prayer.
Let's tell stories of God's power and majesty, his mighty acts throughout history.
For God is great and worthy of our prayer.
Let's remember the compassion he has shown toward us, his mercy and unfailing love, generation after generation.
For God is great and worthy of our prayer.
Let's pass these stories along to our children and grandchildren so that they too may come to know and love our God.
For God is great and worthy of our prayer.
Let's worship God together.
I invite you to stand as you're able for the thanksgiving for baptism. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth and our light and our salvation. Amen. People of God, in the baptismal waters, we travel with Christ from death to life. Our past, our sin, our failure, our doubt, and our shame are drowned and gone here. You, O God, wash us clean. Our fear, our confusion, our self-righteousness, our despair, all are washed away by grace. You, O God, wash us clean. Our pride, our hypocrisy, and other people's opinions of us no longer have the power to define us. You, O God, give us new life. The Spirit lives and moves through us now, a great and joyful mystery, so we may bring love and mercy into the world as the body of Christ. You, O God, give us new life. Rejoice that God has claimed us in this baptismal grace, not by our own doing or believing, but by God's mercy alone. You, O God, give us new life. And so, as we begin worship, we give thanks to God for the glorious gift of baptism that joins us together in Christ by the Spirit's power. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptisms, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. We praise you for the gift of new life in Jesus Christ. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated now while we enjoy our gathering hymn, When Morning Gilds the Skies.
Jesus Christ.
Please stand as you're able. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal God, you show perpetual loving kindness to us, your servants, because we cannot rely on our own abilities. Grant us your merciful judgment and train us to embody the generosity of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And now as we prepare to hear the words from our first lesson, you may be seated. As we prepare to hear the words from Exodus, you know, I shared Genesis over these last couple weeks, but now we shift into Exodus, and this reading begins the second stage, I think, of Israel's long wilderness journey for how many years? 40 years. The defeat of Pharaoh's army at the Sea of Reeds had already taken place, and the people had been provided water to drink at the oasis of Elim. But now already in their second month of their journey, they were out of food, and they were angry and frustrated. And they lash out to whom? They lash out to their leaders, Moses and Aaron. But listen for the abundant grace that Jim is going to share with us, that was shared with the Israelites as they continue to complain. Maybe we should also listen to the same things that God does for us each day.
First reading, Exodus 16, 2 through 15. A reading from Exodus chapter 16. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread. For you have brought us out into the wilderness to kill these whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I'm going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. And that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instructions or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on the other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all of Egypt, "And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaint against the Lord, for what we are, that you complain against us." And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard the complaining that you utter against him, what are we? We complaining is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, and for he has heard your complaining." As if Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat. In the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God." And the evening quails came up and covered the camp. And in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the witnesses was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, "What is this?" For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat." The word of the Lord. Psalms 145, 1 through 8. We shall read Psalms 145 responsively. "I will exalt you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. bless you, your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. There is no end to your greatness.
One generation shall praise your works to another and shall declare your power.
I speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty and all your marvelous works.
They shall tell the might of your wondrous acts, and I will recount your greatness.
They shall publish the remembrance of your great goodness. They shall sing joyfully of your righteousness.
The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. And now, as we continue our worship time, it is children's time, and I thought I had turned my mic on, but I didn't.
So, as we continue, it's now children's message time, and I really wanted to share a message with you today that I think is exuded in both our Old Testament reading as well as our gospel reading. So I wanted to talk to you about us, and I wanted to talk to you about them. So I have these two boomerangs in here. These are what I was told they were called. These are boomerangs. And it kind of provides an optical illusion. So as we look at these readings in the gospel reading that I'm going to share with you in a little bit, the same wages were given to the workers who was out early in the morning and worked all day long versus the people that just came late in the day and worked for an hour for a very short period of time. That doesn't sound very fair, does it? No, not at all. I would not be happy if I was there all day and got paid the same amount as you did or you did when you only worked for a little while. But you know what? God teaches us something new. God teaches us something, a different way to look at things than what we see from our human eyes. So, does God like us better or them better? So, you know, I think the way you see it at home, maybe us is a little bit smaller than them. But let me switch it around. Maybe now God likes us better than them. Now, you would think that, well, why is them smaller than us? Maybe I'm holding it back here like this. No, no, no. I'm holding it at the same distance, and yet them is a little bit smaller. Or maybe it's us or them that God likes better. But really, what we learn in these lessons today is that God loves us all equally, because these two pieces of paper match up identically. For God loves all of his creation the same. You and me. And that is our lesson today. So let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for loving us. Loving us even though sometimes we probably shouldn't be loved as much as somebody else. But still, you love us. Thank you. Amen. And now, brothers and sisters in Christ, let us bless our children as we bless them at our baptism. Children of God, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Amen. Now please stand for the gospel acclamation. Today, the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 20th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. So that today we hear a parable, and we've all heard this parable before, at least many of us, I think, have. I think one of the parables that Jesus shares with us that is quite intriguing, quite difficult to apply to our world today. A landowner provides the same reward at the end of the day to everyone equally. Those who labored from the morning all the way through the day were given the same wages as those who just came towards the end of the day. I say that one way to look at this parable is that through it, we are freed. We are all freed from this commonality of what our earthly world may look like. And we are opened up to discern more clearly, I think, of how God works and looks at the world as a whole. Our world is full of people who labor to make ends meet. But we can never gain enough traction to enjoy what is truly meant by a Sabbath day. This parable exposes how our earthly thinking can clash against God's graces that is so abundant to us and all of creation. Jesus said to the disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for the vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. And when he went out at about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. So he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right.' So they went. When he went out again at about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same thing. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, 'Why are you standing here idle all day?' And they said to him, 'Because no one has hired us.' And he said to them, 'You also go into the vineyard.' When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, 'Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first.' When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. When the first came, they thought that they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, 'These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat.' But he replied to one of them, 'Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to the last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last.' This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. And please be seated. And grace and peace to you in our name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, on this day. So, yes, I am robed once again. And I'm robed for one primary reason. It's chilly in here. No, that's not why. So, yes, we are back. We had our kind of return service, our rally day last weekend, and I am back in full garb trying to be present with you today. And I really love these lessons, and I want to lean mostly on our reading from Exodus, this Old Testament reading. And we hear a good amount of whining, of complaining, very much what was shared with the children during our VBS program this year. And how familiar of a tone for us it is to hear today as we listen to our world. Or maybe that voice is us. There is so much to complain about in this world if we look through our earthly lens. So much. On September 7th, Chemung County had been standing kind of firm at 174 positive COVID cases. And now, as of today, only 14 days later, our numbers have jumped to 266 positive cases, an increase of 92 additional infections. And one of those cases led to the death of a 75, 76-year-old man in our community, one of our neighbors. In just 1 week of school, several classrooms of students are already quarantined. Where will this end? Now, we have neighbors in the Midwest who are struggling with some severe drought. That is there, that rain, that sustenance is there to feed their crops. Drought conditions. And if we look further out into the West, the wildfires continue to rage through California, Oregon, and Washington. I haven't looked at the latest numbers, but I know at least 40 people have died in these fires that have consumed over, are you ready for this number? Over 10 million acres of God's creation. In the southern states, two hurricanes have caused flooding, damage, and death in their wake. Hurricane Laura brought about 77 deaths that I found online, and over $10 billion in damage, leaving many people without their homes, without their livelihoods. Last week, Hurricane Sally, which was much lesser of a hurricane, which ended up really being a tropical storm, but yet it brought much less damage, but yet damage as a result, providing areas filled with flooding and water surges in Florida and Alabama. All of this in our country, while these same people contend with high numbers of COVID cases. So much to complain about. Yes? But let us ask. Let me ask you, who do you complain to? Where do we place our grumblings and our pains and sufferings upon? Is it you? Is it you? Let's look at the Israelites. The Israelites are freed from slavery after questionable, but at least 200 years of slavery, of serving Pharaoh in Egypt. Generations of families knew nothing else but the strong arm of power and control over them. The estimated number of Israelites that are now, in our lesson today, freed from that power and control, freed from slavery, was said to be around 2.4 million people wandering in the desert. And now they were free, yet they longed for someone to care for them, to provide for them food, water, shelter. And they complained. And to whom do they complain to? Moses and Aaron. It had to be their fault, right? They're the ones that led them out of slavery. They're the ones that went to the Pharaoh. They're the ones that got them freed. And how in the world were Moses and Aaron ever going to be able to feed and water 2.4 million people without a little help? Now, this is just the second month of the children of Israel's journey out of Egypt. Just the second month of 40 years. Got a little bit of a journey ahead of them. And the people are frustrated and complaining. And the literal interpretation of the Hebrew word here is murmuring against Moses and Aaron because they are starving. And this, of course, is the third such complaint. And the patterns of these complaints are pretty consistent each and every time. It goes sort of like this. There's a threat. They complain to Moses and Aaron. Moses and Aaron pleads with God. God fixes it, and the people are happy. The cycle continues. First, they are encountered by a potentially devastating threat to their well-being as the pursuit of the Pharaoh and the chariots of his warriors are upon them, and we know that God saves them at the Red Sea. Next, they bring their complaints about dehydration, and yet God directs them to drinkable water in Elim. And today, they once again murmur because of starvation. And yes, God saves them by providing them with bread from heaven in manna. And each time, how strong and powerful and not so nice languages of the people's complaints were against their leaders, as they said, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in Egypt, we would have not had to endure this mess." I mean, we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread, and now you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole congregation with hunger. Now, brothers and sisters in Christ, if you know the stories of the Old Testament, it seems as though hunger may be causing some forgetfulness upon these people. They seem to have some short memory. Maybe we should be reminded that these people, and maybe we should remind these people that Pharaoh, who was the one who was trying to kill them, it was God who rescued them. Yet did they talk to God about their issues? I think it's time to cut through the chase in what we see in not only our gospel lesson, but also in this Old Testament reading from Exodus. Cut through the chase. This text is all about grumbling people in the midst of God's grace. Pretty simple. End of story. But how do we react when it happens in our world? But yet when we look at the Israelites, do the people cry out to God for help? Do the people cry out to God for food? Do they confess their faith in the God who has delivered them from slavery, saved them from certain death, provided them water to quench their thirst? And now, in just less than 2 months' time, do they ask Moses and Aaron to pray to God for them? Do they even ask that? No. There isn't a word stated. There isn't a word pursued that has anything to do with God's grace in the hearts and minds of these people. Not a confession of faith, not a reference to God's promises that have been made to them. And what do they even do? They reject the leadership of Moses and Aaron and blame them for the situation they're in. They completely turn their backs on the God who has done and continues to do the miraculous things for them. Yet the people struggle to know and trust and to follow their God who challenges and allows the people to experience the struggle. Now let us, as a congregation together, let's shake our heads at these Israelites. Let's do it. Do you not get it, people? It's easy for us to be critical of their ungrateful grumbling, but it's also easy to understand human complaints. For I would say, many of us would be right there with them had we been there, don't you think? And I would say that when we see their complaints, we might also look at what's going on in our world today. Look at ourselves in these grumblings. For it's easy for us to forget when God frees us, when God saves us, and provides for each and every blessing that is poured out upon us in our lives today. It's easy to underestimate how gracious God was to the Israelites so long ago, in spite of their grumbling. And in all of the complaining the wanderers did in the wilderness, God was still there for them. God was with them and heard their cries and responded to their needs. And ultimately, the people were continuously blessed with God's graces for all of their needs, and yet could not comprehend the love that was poured out upon them by God. I think it's an amazing tension between this grumbling people, us, on the one hand, and the incomprehensible grace of God on the other, as God gives them exactly what they were grumbling for. And this abundance of grace leads us all to the cross. To the cross, where the true suffering and the true faith of us comes from, where the pain and suffering and the ultimate sacrifice was given for all the pains of the world. What the people Israel should have remembered, and more importantly, I think what we should remember today, is that our God is bigger than any obstacle that can be presented to us in this earthly life. Anything that we can ever be faced with. And the Israelites in our reading today had already seen this time and time again. Yet their faith was lost in the time of trouble. Each time they placed blame upon their human leaders and failed to lean on their divine Redeemer, what is our reaction when things don't go as well as we would like as the COVID numbers increase? as our leaders in different levels of government speak words that don't appeal to us, when we struggle with the education of our youth right here in our communities, the list can go on, brothers and sisters. What is our reactions when things don't go as we would like them? Do we grumble among ourselves, or do we, through many examples of God's actions throughout history, trust in our God and through our faith, pray to God in faithful and hopeful desperation? God continues to provide exactly what we need each and every day of our lives. I know that's hard to embrace sometimes. Even when we don't have the faith to ask for it, our God is there, for God's grace gives life to us, even when we're unable to lean on our faith to ask for God's blessing. Or maybe even to give thanks for what God has provided to us. So, people of God, we too have seen the glory of the Lord many times in our lives. Yet in our hunger and in our thirst, we tend to lose our memory, just as the Israelites did. But through our failed memory, we know that God revealed his glory to the world to see. For the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. That's what God gave Israel as they wandered in the desert, and this is what God gives to us in the deserts of our lives as well. Amen. So now let us enjoy our hymn of the day, Lord of Light, number 688 in the red hymnals.
Lord of light, you are near. With the whole church, let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please sit or kneel as you are able. Drawn together in the compassion of God, we pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Generous God, you make the last first and the first last. Where this gospel challenges the church, equip it for its words of service. Strengthen those who suffer for Christ in their lives. Lord, in your mercy. Sun and wind, bushes and worms, cattle in great cities, nothing in creation is outside your concern. Mighty God, in your mercy, tend to those battling wildfires in this country and give strength to those who help the recovery efforts from the hurricane damage. And give us a spirit of generosity toward all you have made. Lord, in your mercy. Where we find envy and create enemies, you provide enough for all. Bring peace to places of conflict and violence. Inspire leaders with creativity and wisdom. Bless the work of negotiators, peacekeepers, and development workers. We pray especially for those serving in the military, including Christopher Behrens, Angie Gavin, Dylan Hornbeck, Chase Harkick, Jeffrey Kuhn, Warren Kuhn, Michael McCann, Brandon Rogers, Justin Schammel, Logan Sowell, Ryan Taylor, and Eric Weiermiller. Lord, in your mercy. Reveal yourself to all in need as you are gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, ready to relent from punishing. Accompany judges and lawyers, victims of crime, and those serving sentences. Give fruitful labor and a livelihood to those seeking work. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all the members of the faith community. Guide us in our daily lives and help us to show kindness and love to others. This week, we pray for the Osborne family, the Owen family, and the Paris family. Lord, in your mercy. Even beyond our expectations, you choose to give generously. Grant life, health, and courage to all who are in need, especially Chuck and Jan Conkus, Joanne Savino, Maggie Davies, Rachel Holmes, Jennifer Brown, Betty Freeney, Sarah Bush, Joe Brannon, Brittany and Josh Hurd, Mary DeRocher, Hudson Wagle, Diane Wilbur, Dawn Thomas, Mike Malone, Doris Hand, Melissa Winslow, Jennifer Versiglio, Jody Crosby Paglia, Dennis Woodward, Julie Harrison, Josh Wells, Christine Brady, Joe Federcone, Norm Peterson, David Hoffmeyer, Bob Leib, Julie Dory, Owen, Xavier, Mert Janovic, Nancy Wenslow, Debbie Vandewall, Cindy Slater, Ron Slusser, John Bouye, George Swinkey, Paul and Paula Goebel, Bonnie Cummings, Kelly Rice, Kelly Schwartz, Tom and Teresa Hornbeck, Howard Miller, and the family, especially the family of Ruth Bender Ginsburg. And now we name aloud all within our hearts. Hear our prayer. We praise you for the generations that have declared your power to us. Give us faithfulness to follow them, living for Christ, until you call us to join them in the joyful song around this throne. Lord, in your mercy. All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to you, mercy through Christ our Lord. The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of peace with one another.
Peace, my dear. God's peace. Peace to you all. God's peace, Miss Francis. And peace to everyone out there that is in our faith community afar from our present. Oh, yeah. I guess this darn face mask, it kind of messes my sound system up. But peace to you all out there in our faith community that are not present with us today. So as we prepare now for our offering, we do have a plate in the rear of the sanctuary for those of you that are here. But at home, I just wanted to share a little bit more of our stewardship. You know, as we get ready for stewardship, our stewardship drive here again in October, which is not all that long from now, I wanted to share something a little bit different than our financial giving. This past week, we had a number of volunteers in here helping 6 kids in our community. I think we might have had 10 volunteers, 12 volunteers total, something like that, helping these kids. And the work that the ladies and gentlemen did was just awesome. Not only going outside and playing with them, but sitting down beside them and helping them with their assignments, trying to give them guidance and nurturing them for their success in this world. In a time that, where's it going to be this week? What's going to happen tomorrow? So if you would like to be a part of that, please join us. Reach out to myself or Vicky, and we'll get you on this volunteer list. Because in this, many hands make light work. Additionally, there was 9 of us, I think it was yesterday, that put together picnic takeout for 68 people in our community, where we generated, I think, close to $100 for our youth, which will be used to help get our youth to youth gathering, hopefully, in 2022. We'll see how the life goes in this world one day at a time. But just think of the gifts that was given there. Yes, the financial gifts are important, and I appreciate each and every one of you for what you are able to provide to us in this journey. So now let's sit back and discern over our giving as we listen to Francis play our offertory music.
Thank you.
us pray. O God of justice and love, we give thanks to you that you illumine our way through life with the words of your Son. Give us the light we need, awakening us to the needs of others, and at the end bring all the world to your feast. Through Jesus Christ, Savior and Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and glory forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as our Lord taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory
forever and ever. Amen. I invite you to please be seated for our announcements today. We have a few announcements in the bulletin, all of which have changed because that's what we do in this time of turmoil, right? Of course, we're not having coffee hour or fellowship time today. The food pantry is in pretty good shape, but we always appreciate your support on that. Our remote learning center, we did find someone, I think, for Wednesday morning. But listen, we are always in need. We have substitutes just fitting in here and there. We would never put anyone with somebody that hasn't done it or isn't experienced. So if you just have an afternoon or a morning and would like to put in a few hours, just a one-time thing, reach out to myself or Vicki. We could really use this help. And I think as we see the numbers of COVID in our area continuing to not look all that great, I'm hopeful that it will turn positive or in the right direction. Let me put it that way. But who's going to be the biggest need if our schools, as in-person education, goes downhill? We really need to put ourselves out there as best as we can, as best as we feel comfortable in doing, to help our children of our Elmira and greater communities. So if you feel called to do that, please let me know. Please let Vicki know so that we can do that. I do have an announcement. Cynthia wants to share some stuff with us, and that way I can catch my breath.
So as many of you know, Vicki has done an amazing job of cleaning up this whole church and pulling things together. And one of the things that she pulled together was a number of old pictures and posters that had pictures on it. Some of it was when we did the combined timeline. So we have bins of photos. And at this point, we really need to get a small group of people together to go through those. I'll say that I've done a little bit of that with some of the old Holy Trinity photos when I was going through all of the files. And it's actually quite fun to just see some of these photos from, 60, 80 years ago. It's like really amazing. So what we're looking for is, 3 to 4 people, some representation from both Bethany and from former Holy Trinity, because the pictures are all sort of mixed together at this point. And just get a group of people to go through them, organize them, put them in something that's going to keep them safe. And so 100 years from now, hopefully people can enjoy them as well. So if you are interested in that, please either let me know or let Tina know in the office, and we can gather that group together. Thanks.
Yeah, and to echo on what Cynthia is saying, one of the things that I have recognized since I've been here is our history, especially as the two congregations has now come together as one. To have a succinct place to where we can go and see and reflect upon our history has been problematic. So whatever we can do to improve upon that will be a benefit for us all. Because while we don't lean into our history. It's our history that's what brings us forward into this century that we live in today. So thank you for your efforts on that, Cynthia. And thanks to Vicki, as we have gotten a lot of that stuff at least all in one place to where we have a place to start. A few other things. Tomorrow, guess what I'm going to do all day? I'm going to play golf. Well, that might be what we call it. So I want to thank you all that have already contributed or pledged to my golfing fundraiser for the Transformation Center. So every penny that you donate in the honor of me playing golf, well, I have to play golf tomorrow. So it will go straight to the Transformation Center. I know I have already gotten pledges that exceed over $1,500 from this group of people. So thank, and I have to play golf now. So how tough is that? So the plan is I'm supposed to play from daybreak. We're meeting at the golf course at 6:30 in the morning. I'm sure it'll be warm. And we're playing until sunset. So every hole that I play, those of you that pledged a per hole rate of 25 cents all the way up, I've got some people that have pledged $2 a hole. However many holes I get in, I'm shooting for 90. I've never done that before. I may not be in on Tuesday. No, I gotta be. But a little Bengay and a little prayer will be fine. But the wonderful thing is we're helping an organization that is really connected to this faith community in the old Holy Trinity facility, who is serving this community in huge ways, beyond what even I can fathom. So every penny that you're able to provide is a blessing. Those of you that have committed to serving, after I golf tomorrow, I'll let you know exactly how many holes I did manage to get in. And oh, by the way, it's not for a good score. It's for the quantity, not quality, of holes played. So I will let you know how many holes I played, and then we can do the math. And if you would send in your gifts that you pledged, X amount of cents or dollars per hole, write out the total check to Bethany Lutheran Church and put down in the comments golf-a-thon or golf, whatever is the easiest. And then I'm going to ask the finance team to just write one check that we will send to the Transformation Center, and each and every person's name that pledged will be listed on a separate sheet so that you will receive some thank yous in the mail from that. Any questions? Any questions? So, we talk about our griping and our complaining. This is a time to step up. If you know someone that says, well, I don't vote, it doesn't matter anyway, send them my way. Or you can pick up one of these signs out back and stick it in their yard until they get upset at you and they finally concede and go and vote. If you need any voter registration information, any voter absentee ballot information, we have it here. Please get out and vote. I have sent an email out to our hospitality team and hoping that they would take up this task, but we know that Tom and Teresa Hornbeck have been positively tested with coronavirus. And so they're struggling at home, they're in quarantine, they're thankfully, as I spoke to them yesterday, their symptoms are not dreadful, but needless to say, they do have COVID. They did not get it as a result of the Baptist Church. They got it through what it sounds like a client of Teresa as she provides home care for a number of people. So that has then passed on to Tom as well. So we're looking to try to provide them with some meals over these next couple weeks. So if you feel as you can help with that, either reach out to me right now. I'm not sure if anyone on hospitality is going to do that, but we as a faith community need to help this wonderful couple as they're secluded to their homes. So if we don't help, then who? Our floor, we were going to be getting our new floor in a welcoming area as well as on, in the restrooms this next week. That got pushed out because of COVID to the 28th and 29th. One of the installers has, his mother tested positive with COVID, and that mother was the caregiver of his child. So that he's now in quarantine. So that will, his 14 days hopefully will go well, and then he will be here next Monday to help us install the floors. That's all I have with our announcements. If there is anything else, please shout it out. If you're out there online, please share it in Facebook, and we will make sure that that gets shared a great deal. But I will not be in the office tomorrow, but my phone is always with me. So if there is a pastoral need, feel free to reach out to me on my phone. As long as you don't slow me down from getting more hold. No, I'm. But my day job is very important to me, so please call. Or you can also call Tina, who will be here at the office. I now invite you to stand as you're able for the benediction. Mothering God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit bless you and lead you into the way of truth and life. Amen. Now you may be seated as we listen to our closing hymn, Rise Up, O Saints of God, and I invite the ushers to start sharing our sanitization products with the community. Lastly, I cannot go without thanking all of the people who have been here to make worship possible today. You know, Kirk and Cynthia are always here on our sound system to make it possible. We had Ruth that was our cantor today. We had Judy and we had Jim and Sharon being our readers. And of course, always Francis being here to play for us and lead us in music. And I don't want to forget my wonderful contact tracer, Vicky, who stands at guard at the door and takes everybody's questions and writes down our information. So with that, may you go in peace. Remember the poor. Thanks be to God.